Salmon Run. The game mode introduced in Splatoon 2 that has you hunting salmonids and providing golden eggs to the mighty Grizzco company has been brought back into Splatoon 3 as well. I'm not the best Splatoon player in the world, far from it actually. Neither am I the best Salmon Run player in the world, far from it too. However, I did spend a significant amount of time back in Splatoon 2 playing Salmon Run. I'm so passionate about it that I really wanted to make a compilation of tips and tricks from the many hours I put into the game mode. This video is dedicated to beginner players who just got Splatoon 3 as their first Splatoon game this September. However, there are also many tips and tricks included that I'm sure even some experienced players don't know about. If you're a Salmon Run pro whose goal is to clear high scores with your egg quotas, then this video probably isn't the most informative to you. Still, whether you're a beginner player or you've had some sort of Salmon Run experience already, I'm sure there's something here that can benefit you and help you level up your Salmon Run games. This video is divided into a few sections. There's a general introductory section where I talk about some general information regarding Salmon Run, such as objectives, tides, bonuses, weapon sets, and so on. Secondly, I'll go over all the different types of boss salmonids as well as effective tips to combating them. Thirdly, I'll talk about all the special nighttime events too. Fourthly, I will go over all the specials you can get in Salmon Run. And finally, I'll talk about the XTRAWAVE. There are timestamps in this video description that lets you jump to each of the different sections, so feel free to put those to good use. I wish to emphasize that this video is also written and scripted with solo queue in mind. Obviously, if you have teammates you are in a voice call with, you can come up with more fancy strategies and communicate better, but this video focuses on those who are mainly playing with randoms. Also note that this guide is written with winning and climbing up ranks as the priority, not obtaining a high record of golden eggs. Also, before we get started, I just want to talk about cannons for a bit, because it can get really confusing. Just to be clear for the rest of the video, I will refer to the default cannon you use to shoot eggs as the egg cannons, the cannons during cohawk charges as the cohawk cannons, the cannons that big shots use as the big shot cannons, and finally, the cannons that are given to you during extra waves as the extra wave cannons. I know that these are not their cannon names, pun absolutely intended, but hopefully this does not cause any confusion. Without further ado, let's get straight into it, shall we? Salmon Run's objective as a game mode is simple to explain, but there are a lot that goes into it. Essentially, you go into Salmonid territory, attack the boss Salmonids, illegally appropriate their precious golden eggs, fulfill your quota, and stay alive for 3 waves. Do that, and you get awarded 20 points, as well as bonuses in a variety of forms, such as drink tickets, ability chunks, gears that you can swap for more ability chunks, and also money. Do note, if you're playing with a friend lower rank than you, you do not get the 20 points, but you do get the bonuses. For each rotation, you can also get 2 super bonuses that net you more reward than usual. After you get all the bonuses for the day, you can get a gear for every 200 points, until eventually the reward reduces to a gear every 400 points. The quotas for the golden eggs get increasingly higher as your rank increases. You start as an intern, before ranking up to apprentice, part-timer, go-getter, overachiever, professional part-timer, 3 levels of professional, and finally getting to executive VP. The higher your rank, the more easily you can collect your bonuses as well. At the start of every wave, there's a visual indicator of what the tides of the wave will be in. There's high tides, normal tides, or low tides, and you can adjust your strategies accordingly. Generally, it's good practice to ink turf around the field so that you have more space to work around. This is especially vital during high tides. Take advantage of inking walls as a means of accessing shortcuts to the basket. If you get splatted, your teammates will have to revive you by tagging you with their ink, and if you all get splatted, the game ends. If you have a weapon bad for turfing, like a charger, you can always use a bomb as a quick way to revive. Remember to take advantage of the egg cannons too, especially on low tides. They consume as much ink as a bomb, so take care of your ink conservation. Between waves, you get revived automatically if you're splatted, though you do start the wave 1 or 2 seconds later than your teammates who are alive. Losing in wave 1 gives you a 20 point pay cut, losing in wave 2 gives you a 10 point pay cut, and losing in wave 3 does not give you any pay cuts at all. If you have any disconnects in your team, losing in wave 1 gives you a 10 point pay cut, and losing in wave 2 gives you a 5 point pay cut instead. Please also remember that even though you have fulfilled the quota, you can still lose the run if your entire team gets wiped out, even in wave 3. To maximize victories, I recommend players to play defensively once you've obtained the quotas. Usually after getting the quota, I volunteer myself to move to a less crowded area in the field, separate from the rest of my team. This is because the enemies that swarm the team can get overwhelming at times, and there are countless times I find myself being the only one alive. A steel hitter's explosion, flyfish's tentacle missiles, and steel eels swarming the baskets can end runs in a blink of an eye. From a distance, you can use bombs or long-range weapons to revive your friends too, as long as you keep a reasonable distance away from your teammates and are ready to revive if things go south. I find this to be a good way to play defensively. During low tides, I usually move to the high tide place once I reach quota. This serves two purposes. One, it lets you play defensively, as mentioned earlier. When you're all the way up there, boss salmonids are less likely to follow you all the way up, meaning there's a high chance for you to stay alive. Most of the time, the only enemies you need to worry about are stinger lasers, who tend to target the furthest player from them, and also flyfish's tenta missiles, which are not restricted by range. If your team gets wiped out, you can always return and revive your friends. 2. This also gives you time to paint the high tide place in preparation for the upcoming wave. You never know if that extra ink in the ground can save you or your teammates in your next wave, yet inking around is generally a good practice after all. Of course, if your goal is to get the most amount of eggs as possible and set records, then this is not recommended, but for winning and surviving, this really helps a lot. Every rotation, there are 4 fixed weapons you are loaned and they shuffle around for every wave. These 4 weapons stay until the end of the rotation. If you want to practice the weapons, you can use this box in the Salmon Run lobby. From time to time, there are rotations with completely random weapons too. You might even get Grizzco weapons, which are illegal, overpowered weapons. At the time of writing this video, the only one I had access to was a Grizzco stringer. So I'll save Grizzco weapons for a future video or maybe a YouTube short after I get footage for the rest of them. Before I move to the boss salmonids, I want to quickly talk about lesser salmonids, i.e. the enemies that do not drop golden eggs. They may not be boss salmonids, but they can be really strong too. I've been killed by too many chums and small fries to count, so don't underestimate them. A dynamo roller can one-shot quahogs and by extension anything lesser by rolling over them, so take advantage of those if you have one. The thing I want to focus more on are the snatchers, which are the purple-haired salmonids on the propellers that steal golden eggs. Every wave, the snatchers come from a fixed location and then return to that fixed location after repossessing golden eggs. It is possible to optimize this, as you can essentially let them bring the eggs to the basket for you by killing them near the basket. Personally, I find this strategy too inconsistent and time-specific to take full advantage of. I would rather use my time to kill boss salmonids or ink turf instead of doing mental gymnastics trying to find out where the snatchers will come from and will return to. Then again, I have like 2 brain cells. Some really good players can take advantage of this information, so just keep that in mind when you play. Now we get into the main meat of the video, the boss salmonids. These creatures are your priority in Salmon Run games, as fulfilling the quota using the golden eggs that they drop is the main objective of the game mode. First and foremost, I want to emphasize very importantly, each weapon in a team is expected to fulfill certain roles when it comes to killing boss salmonids. I will go into detail each of the boss salmonid types later, but for now, I just want to give an example of what I mean. A blaster is extremely good against stingers because its blasts allow you to essentially kill them with 2 shots, but chargers are not the best at it since it has a slow fire rate, meaning you have to spam the button to kill it. Flipper floppers require you to paint a circle around its ground fast, so wide range weapons or fast fire rate weapons are more effective than, say, a splatling that requires you to charge a few seconds before you can fire. Since the weapons you get are random every wave, you have to consciously think about what your weapons are good at, bad at, and adjust accordingly. Every boss salmonid also has different priorities depending on different circumstances. For example, mobs and scrappers are generally low priority since they will move towards you. If you are near the basket, you can wait until they approach the egg basket before killing them. This allows you to gather their eggs quickly too, making them less important to take out first compared to something like a flyfish, for example, that can fire missiles at you from the opposite side of the map. The higher the enemy's priority, the more you have to go out of your way to kill it, and vice versa. I will now go through each of the bosses individually. Steelheads are generally low to mid priority. Since they actively move towards you, you can wait until they are close to the basket before taking them out. To kill one, you have to wait until the orb on its head is exposed, and then destroy it. You can only kill it when the orb is on its head, not after it's been thrown. Chargers are by far the best way of dealing with them, as most chargers can one-shot a steel head with a full charge, except the bamboozler that takes 2 shots instead. Some powerful weapons are really good at dealing with them too. For example, the Tentabrella kills it with 2 shots, certain long-range weapons like Splatling are good at attacking them, a Dynamo or Flingsized Roller's vertical swing can one-shot them. If you have something like a Slosher, you can pre-fire your weapon a few frames before its orb gets exposed. This allows you to deal more damage, and you can even kill it without needing to wait for it to expose its orb again. Steel Eels are generally low priority, so you can wait until they get closer to the basket before intercepting them. Most weapons are good against them, so you don't have to worry too much about weapon effectiveness. To kill one, you have to attack its tail, as the rest of its body is impervious to any damage whatsoever. However, it is important to prioritize on killing them when any of the following happens. Or, even worse, if there's a combination of them. 1. They are next to the basket. 2. It's high tide. 3. It's late game and your quota is not met. And 4. And most deadly of all, when there's multiple of them. Multiple steel eels can coil around each other so that their tails are protected by each other's bodies, so having them swarm someplace as important as the basket is almost always an instant loss if your quota has not been fulfilled. You can attack them from high ground, or take advantage of someone being targeted on low ground and attack them from behind. They might be low priority, but that doesn't mean you cannot weaken it as it approaches the basket. It can make it easier for your teammates to finish them off later. Scrappers are very easy to deal with, especially if you have a weapon with high fire rate like a Splatoon. They are also very low priority, and they are very unthreatening most of the time. Take care of them only when they are close to the basket to make life easier for yourself. To defeat one, you have to attack it from the back just like the Steel Eel. However, if you put in a concentrated attack from the front, you can stop the scrapper in its tracks. If you see your teammate attacking a scrapper from the front, you can attack it from the back as part of your synergy. Likewise, if you see your teammate attacking its back, you can shoot it from the front so that its back is exposed to your teammate. If you attack it, it faces the direction you move to unless you stun it. Overall, I would say scrappers are one of the least threatening enemies in the game, so don't worry about them too much if there's more pressing matters to attend to. Now, stingers. These are one of the highest priority boss salmonids in my opinion. They always spawn near the water, they never approach the basket, they can shoot lasers that pierce through walls, and they tend to target the furthest player from it. You really have to go out of your way to defeat the stingers as soon as possible, as they are extremely frivolous and can annoy the rest of your team with incessant lasers. This is what makes them high priority targets. Like I mentioned earlier, blasters are effective, and so are fast fire rate weapons. On the other hand, slow fire rate weapons like chargers are less effective against them. After taking care of the stinger, you can use your egg cannon to shoot the eggs back so that your teammates can put them into the basket. Moths are pretty low priority most of the time. They approach you, jump out of the ground and chomp you. If you drop a bomb where it would appear, you can instantly kill it. Considering its easy to kill attribute and the fact that they move towards you, I consider them to be low priority. However, if it's late game and your quota has not been met, they are high priority targets since they give easy golden eggs for you to clutch the quota. As long as there's a bomb near the vicinity of the ring, the bomb will automatically be sucked into the moth's mouth regardless of how close it is to exploding. This means you can also do quick flicks like this and they will work well too. They do one-shot you though, so be careful and take proper steps to ensure good ink management habits when moths are around. Drizzlers are one of the more annoying boss salmonids in this game. They jump to one location, shoot a rain pellet, hide in its shell, shoot another rain pellet, and then jump to another location and repeat the pattern. You can approach them in two ways depending on the circumstances. First, you can deflect the rain pellet back at it, assuming you have the right angle for it. If you do this, the resulting explosion will kill it in one hit, even if it's hidden under its shell. This is generally the preferred way of dealing with one, but you do need to be a distance away from it, so that option is not always available to you. Do note that even if you do not have the angle to deflect the rain pellet back to the drizzler itself, deflecting the rain pellet away and stopping the ink storms from forming is always good, as outside the ink storms, the drizzler cannot damage your team otherwise. The rain pellets can also hurt other bosses too, and it might even blow up a flyfish's trash can wings if you're lucky enough. Secondly, you can also attack its exposed body after it shoots its rain pellet. Most of the time, you need to wait for it to expose its body again, as you typically cannot deal enough damage to kill it in one go. However, certain weapons like the Splush-O-Matic or Splatter Shot absolutely can destroy drizzlers in one go, so experiment around and see what works. Also remember that while it is jumping, its body is exposed at the bottom, and you can damage it with a long-range weapon. How you choose to deal with it depends on the circumstances, the position you're at, the weapon you have, etc. I consider them mid to high priority. At least deflecting the pellets is high priority, even if you do not have the right angle to kill the drizzler with it. You may not need to prioritize on defeating them, but stopping the rain pellets from forming is really important for your team's mobility. If the drizzler is facing a direction that does not threaten the rest of your team, you can choose to attack its body instead of deflecting the rain pellet. If you have teammates that back you up, you can even do something like this. My god, flyfish are the worst. They send homing tenta missiles at your teammates, forcing you to reposition over and over again, while limiting your own mobility. The splash damage is no joke, and you might accidentally kill others with their missiles aimed at you, or you might be killed by missiles aimed at other people. To kill them, you need to throw two splat bombs at the trash can wings, which basically requires you to either have a teammate with you that targets a different trash can from you, or to spend time refilling your ink before another bomb can be used. They do not move towards the basket, so you have to go out of your way to kill them. Sometimes the bombs randomly bounce off like I don't know. For all those reasons, I consider Flyfish to be the highest priority boss salmonid in Salmon Run. If you simply do not have enough time to deal with the Flyfish, you can at least partially cripple its damage output by blowing up one of its two trash can wings, limiting the amount of missiles it can shoot. Missiles from the left blue trash can target a random player, while missiles from the right red trash can target the closest player to its view. I am not kidding when I say, try your best to cripple Flyfish as much as possible even if you cannot kill it. They are by far the worst enemy in Salmon Run. Two more things to add. 1. If you see a teammate already intending to intercept the Flyfish, you can support them by moving next to them. You cannot directly communicate with them in solo queue, of course, but there is usually an implied understanding that where you stand correlates with which trash can you will target. If you're standing on your teammate's right, you can try aiming for the right trash can and vice versa. 2. The Explosion weapon is extremely useful against Flyfish. Lobbing an Explosion ink at the trash cans can destroy them without the need to use a bomb. If you happen to have an Explosion as your weapon, Flyfish duty is on you. Fish sticks, or helicopters as I call them, carry a pole that drills onto the ground. After that, it remains stationary, spreading ink in a circular, carousel-like manner. If you have a fast fire rate weapon, you can climb up to the pole and defeat them swiftly. If you have a long-range weapon like a splatling or a dually squelcher, you might not even need to climb up the pole at all. After killing them, you can shoot the eggs off the tower using your egg cannons. If you do defeat all of the flying enemies before the pillar is drilled onto the ground, the entire pillar shatters and is unusable. Personally, I think it's very important to prioritize fish sticks based on how close they are to your basket or other important vantage points. For example, in this clip, I go for the fish stick that's near my base, prioritizing that over the other one that's a little bit of a distance away. The second fish stick is still relatively close to my basket though, so I prioritize it after the first fish stick as compared to the other boss salmonids. Likewise, look at this fish stick right here. It's not in a location that blocks off a significant area around the basket, so I prioritize it less compared to the other boss salmonids, such as the flipper flopper right here, which is next to my basket and poses an immediate threat. You can use the sticks they leave behind to get high ground and avoid enemy attacks. Though remember that flyfish, moss, drizzlers, and stingers can still attack you while you're up there. If you happen to have a splatling or other long-range weapons, you can also take advantage of the high ground to revive teammates or attack other bosses. Flipper floppers, or dolphins as I call them, are pretty straightforward to take out, though it does depend heavily on what weapon you have. The dolphins hop out of the ground, sending a ring of enemy ink onto the ground, and after a few seconds, they dive back into the ring. Just like the Splat Zone's game mode, you have to ink a majority of that zone to prevent it from diving back, making them stuck, unable to do anything but flail desperately. You can then take the chance to kill it. If you do not kill it within a set amount of time, it dives back into the ground again, so remember to do that. If you are within the circle when the dolphin dives back down, you get instantly killed, so be careful. You can attack it without having filled the ring with your ink, but it has a lot of HP, so it's probably less worth it for you to do that. If you have a bad surfing weapon like a charger or a bamboozler, it might be best to leave it to other members of your team who has a more suitable weapon. However, do remember that a well-positioned bomb plus your main weapon, with proper timing, can still take care of the dolphins, so it's probably worth trying that if your teammates cannot back you up in time. Priority-wise, I would say they are less important to deal with first. They're slightly less easy to deal with than moss, but they're still a good way of clutching eggs if you're running low on time for the quota. When most people see Salmon Lit, or UFOs as I call them, they find them to be extremely annoying. They provide a shield for anything under it, and constantly spawn in lesser salmonids like chums too. They are very unthreatening, but they can end runs if they happen to prevent you from killing all the high priority enemies under its protection. You approach salmonids by walking under them, baiting them to come crashing down before climbing up the UFO and splatting the pilot on top of it. You can do a quick squid roll backwards too if you want. If you have a charger, splatling, or other long-range weapons, you can also bring them down from a distance. If you do climb onto the UFO, just be careful and check if there's bodies of water under you. When fighting the UFOs, you constantly have to pay attention to what's under them and take advantage of them. You can use Salmon Lit to deal massive damage, if not completely destroy whatever is under you, so be sure to take full advantage of that. For example, you can use a Salmon Lit to take care of Steel Eel, Stingers, Steelheads, Flyfish, Big Shots, or Scrapper that are directly under them. If you're lucky enough, you can even take out Drizzlers too while they're jumping. This is extremely useful, so constantly think of ways you can use the UFOs to your benefit. Priority-wise, I would say they are generally low priority, but they become high priority when an opportunity arises for you to take out other boss salmonids with it. If the UFO is near your basket, it's not a super high priority to deal with it right away, but dealing with it gives you some space to move around, and putting the eggs into the basket will also be convenient. If there are multiple UFOs, or let's say a fish stick, you can climb onto one, finish the other one off before finishing off the UFO you're standing on, easily netting you 6 eggs. You can always use the height advantage to help target other bosses too. Do remember that you cannot stay on the UFO for too long, as the pilot can push you off with a ladle and you cannot jump over it. Do you remember that one stage in a single player campaign where you have to jump over a bunch of shockwaves on the ground? Yeah, big shots are what that mission is trying to prepare you for. Big shots appear on the beaches, and using their big shot cannons, they fire a sphere to the base that sends off 2 shockwaves that you need to jump over. Defeat the big shot, and you can use their big shot cannons to shoot the eggs to the basket. Unlike the normal egg cannons that you have, big shot cannons do not consume your ink, so go ham on those. If you have teammates in your voice chat, you can tell them to get ready to put the eggs into the basket. Remember, you can use the big shot cannons to shoot eggs from other boss salmonids as well. So if there are many boss salmonids surrounding the big shot cannon, take advantage of it. I believe there can only be one big shot cannon each wave, so all big shots will spawn from near the same location. In this clip, I'm fighting one big shot, but the second big shot that appears also approaches the big shot cannon used by the first big shot. This leads me to believe there can only be one big shot cannon per wave. Priority-wise, take care of them fast. I will put them as high priority as the likes of stingers or flyfish for two reasons. 1. You can take advantage of the big shot cannons, so you don't have to worry too much about sending the golden eggs back. 2. And more importantly, the shockwaves they send off can get really overwhelming, especially when there are multiple big shots at the beach. Save your teammates the headache of jumping over waves while being targeted by lots and lots of boss salmonids or lesser salmonids by stopping the big shots fast. If possible, bring a teammate with you, since big shots have high HP, but be careful not to die and get stranded out there by yourself. If you have a dynamo roller, you can defeat them very easily too. That was a lot to digest, huh? Well, we're not even close to being done yet. I'll now go through the nighttime events, starting with fogs. There's not much to say about fogs, it is pretty much just a glorified normal wave. but it does come with two differences. 1. Obviously there is fog that limits your visibility, so communicate with your teammates using this way more often. 2. There are these goldies that appear sometimes. Let them come to the basket so it's easier to collect their eggs. They have a chance of dropping 1, 5, or 10 eggs, and as far as I know, there's no pattern involved, it's just completely RNG. So you just have to pray for it to drop that 10 eggs. Other than that, there's really not much to say, it's just like any other Salmon Run wave. Have you ever lost to a Glowflies wave before? You have? Well, pat yourself on the back because you tried your best even if you didn't get a single egg into the basket. Glowflies are by far the hardest wave you can get as a nighttime event, and it's extremely weapon dependent. How it works is that Glowflies will swarm one of your teammates randomly, and a bunch of chumps and goldies charge towards that member. Take care of reviving your members if they are splatted, and also keep ink management in mind. The Glowflies will sometimes switch targets, so always be conscious of which teammate is being targeted. Honestly, my only advice is just to use the weapons you have to the best of your ability. If you feel threatened, run out of ink, or your teammates need to be revived, especially on wave 1, don't hesitate to use your specials. It's better to play the rest of the waves without specials than to die to Glowflies and lose your hard-earned 20 rank points. In certain maps, if you are being targeted, you can climb up high walls so your teammates can revive each other or put eggs into the basket. Sending out Tentabrella might be a good way of taking care of enemies in a row. If you have a ruler class weapon, you can put the ruler down and move slightly forward. Since the rulers do massive damage, you can be in the front lines to help your teammates, and only moving slightly means reducing the amount of ink you use. The enemies do push you backwards though, so be careful of your movement and of your ink conservation. A dynamo ruler is extremely effective for this strat. Just don't do this with the carbon ruler, or this happens. In certain maps, there are locations that the enemies cannot reach, though their effectiveness can differ since glowflies can change targets at any time, and I don't see this being very useful, especially in high-level lobbies. I'm sure people will be able to take advantage of this eventually though, but for now, I don't foresee that happening anytime soon. Grillers are generally very difficult, though I find them to be easier than glowflies. In this wave, you have to shoot the griller's exposed tail on its back. Deal enough damage to it, and more of its tentacles will be exposed, allowing you to attack from multiple angles instead of just from the back. They drop 5 golden eggs instead of the usual 3. Teammates that are targeted by the grillers have a red line pointed toward them from the griller, and you will instantly get splatted if you are run over by them. Try killing it in a place close to a basket so egg collection becomes easier. If you are being targeted, it can go up or down certain platforms to change your trajectories too. Just like with glowflies, you can climb up high walls to stall the grillers and give your teammates the breather needed to revive and put eggs into the basket. Just be careful not to do this during high tides, otherwise this happens. Quahog charges only happen on low tides, so keep an eye out for those. We are given multiple Quahog cannons to use, and I usually find a balance between 2 cannon users and 2 egg collectors to be effective. These waves are pretty easy overall, provided you don't kill most of the low priority enemies far away from the basket. You can use the Quahog cannons to destroy steelheads, as well as destroy Flyfish's trash cans. Big shots are an important target to take out as well, since they are far from the basket and they have high HP. Stingers are also very important targets to take out. If you are on egg collection duty, remember to use your egg cannons more frequently, as they can help those who are near the baskets to collect eggs easier. If you are on the Quahog cannons, be mindful of the amount of ink you have and constantly hop out to refill if needed. Remember that you can still be targeted while you're inside the Quahog cannons. Moss, steel eels, flyfish missiles, and flipper floppers are some of the worst enemies for you, since most of them can one-shot you, so be careful. Gushers can be pretty RNG, so it can be very easy or very hard depending on your team's luck and synergy together. You open up gushers around the map to find goldies hiding inside them. The higher the green liquid shoots up, the closer the goldie is to you. On the contrary, the shorter the green liquid shoots up, the further away the goldie is from you. Don't open every single gusher. Use the green liquid's height to make the best estimate you can. If you find one, use this way to inform your friends. Work with your team and kill it, and get as many eggs into the basket as quickly as possible. Do remember that the more damage the goalie has taken, the faster they escape. I typically start by opening the gusher furthest away from the basket. This is so that if you guess incorrectly, the spawning enemies won't get to the basket too quickly and overwhelm your path. If you have a dynamo roller, you can get a lot of eggs by just pushing it against the goldie. Once you've got the quota, if you wish to secure your victory and minimize all risks, you can choose not to open any more gushers so that enemies appear less frequently. Instead, you can spend your time painting around in preparation for the next wave. The Mothership is one of the easiest nighttime events in Salmon Run. The motherships appear from the sea along with lots of flying chinooks that carry small crates. If you leave the small crates be, salmonids pop out of them. You wanna know how I know those flying things are called chinooks? Because I got splatted by one. Yeah, I got killed by the crate explosions. I didn't even know that was possible, but oh, it very much is. Splat the chinooks and you get one golden egg each. During the wave, the mothership will approach the egg basket two times in an attempt to steal the eggs already deposited inside the basket. Just because you already have quota does not mean you can be relaxed in this mode. However, the game tells you when the mothership approaches the basket, and you can shoot the mothership to stop its advances too. Overall, you really need to worry about the lesser salmonids, that's all. Don't worry too much about this mode, it's very easy. Mudmouth eruptions are also very easy. In fact, unless you're on a really really high difficulty, there is next to no reason to lose these waves. Mudmouths appear in gushers all over the map, spawning lesser salmonids from their mouth. Throw a bomb three times into its mouth and it's defeated. Each bomb throw gives you one egg, and defeating it gives you three more. The golden mudmouths spawn quahogs and take more bombs to defeat, but the same strat still applies. Just like flyfish, you can use the explosher as a substitute for bombs during the mudmouth eruptions, so take advantage of that as well. The more painful your expansions are, the closer they are to being defeated, so that's a handy trick to help you prioritize as well. Honestly, there's not much to say about mudmouths, and there really is no reason to lose these, especially considering it is one of the least weapon-dependent modes in this game. Remember when I said mudmouth eruptions and mothership are easy? Well, giant tornadoes are the easiest nighttime event you can get. These only occur in low tides, but a boulder prevents access to the basket in the low tide area. At the beginning of the wave, you can hear thunders rumbling, so that's a good indication for you that the tornado is here. Work with your team to carry all the golden eggs to the basket at a high tide area. Form a conga line with your friends to use the egg cannons to transport the eggs. Each of the eggs count for two, so you only need half the amount of eggs as required by the quota. From time to time, lesser salmonids drop down from the tornado. Just work together to take care of them. Of course, if you have extra time, you can ink high tide places too, or try to go for a high record if you like. There's really not much to say about this mode. It's really, really easy. Just like mudmouths, there's really no reason to lose these. Now we get to the specials. In each Salmon Run game, you only get 2 uses of specials throughout the 3 waves, so try your best to preserve them until wave 3, or until the time is right for them. For example, there's almost no reason to use your specials during mudmouth, mothership, or giant tornadoes, unless it's a really bad emergency where half of your team is wiped out. If you happen to have already obtained the quota in waves 1 and 2, there's also no reason to use your specials unless it's genuinely a bad emergency that can threaten the entire run. If you can make it to wave 3 without using your specials, then don't hesitate to use them all in wave 3. This is because in the event of an extra wave, you are given and allowed to use only one special, no more and no less. If you have not obtained your quota and there are less than 30 to 40 seconds left on the clock, or half your team is dead, it's time to start thinking about using your specials. Don't wait until there's only like 15 to 10 seconds left to use your specials, because there simply won't be enough time to put in the eggs, even if you kill all the boss salmonids with your specials. I will now go over each of the 7 specials you can get in Salmon Run, and discuss how to use them effectively. Inkjets are quite hard to use, especially for beginners, but they can come in pretty handy when used at the right time. You can destroy flyfish trash cans by aiming your inkjet at them, destroy steelhead's orbs, and also deal massive damage if not one-shot stingers too. Inkjet is a pretty good special to use in a pinch, it can revive your teammates pretty well too. Just remember that while you're on grates, you cannot fly up. If you trigger inkjet near the basket, you can even pick up an egg and use the inkjet's finish to return to the basket for one quick egg deposit. It's very useful, especially in situations where there are multiple stingers at the same location, considering how stingers are high priority bosses as discussed before. Booyah Bomb is easily one of the best specials you can get in Salmon Run. You can use it to kill off almost anything with an armor, like scrappers or flyfish, and revive a bunch of teammates together too. In this clip, my Booyah Bomb revived both of my teammates and killed off a steelhead simultaneously. Booyah Bomb is really useful in many situations, especially during glowflies or griller events too. They can do basically everything. Reviving your teammates, destroying bosses, stalling in mid-air, turfing an area to make movement easier, it's an amazing special all around. You do have an armor while you're charging up, but concentrated attacks from flyfish or steel eel can still crack it, so be careful. If you have a Booyah Bomb, please don't waste it on small fries, please. I feel like Crab Tank is one of the more underwhelming specials in this game, since it significantly limits your mobility. Maybe if I played Crab Tanks more often in like Turf Wars or Ranked, I would be one with the special and use it to its fullest potential. It's not a special I would use most of the time. You move very slow forward, but you do move faster sideways. I can see it being useful to revive a group of teammates who are together, or to clear off a bunch of enemies in a straight narrow path, but I find it to be very underwhelming. The best part about the Crab Tank is its range, and you can use it to attack stingers or boss enemies from a distance, though you do have to be careful of moths and flyfish. If anyone has any good tips for using the Crab Tank, feel free to let me know in the comments. I would love to hear more of what you have to say about it. The Killer Whale is, as its name suggests, a killing special. It's not the greatest at reviving teammates because the beams automatically home into boss enemies. We can take advantage of this, however, as the Killer Whale pierces through enemy armors. It can kill most of the enemies, including flyfish, steelhead, stingers, and even grillers too. Just remember that the Killer Whale fires in response to where you're aiming with your gyro or with your sticks, so you can go off track too from time to time. In desperate situations where you're separated from the rest of your team, you can still try to revive using this special. Just don't expect to work out the way you want it to. I feel like the Reef Slider isn't a super great special in the sense that its usefulness is quite scenario specific. It can be good at reviving teammates, as well as forging a path in places surrounded by enemy ink. I can certainly think of situations where it's good, but I don't think it's as flexible as, say, Booyah Bomb or Triple Ink Strike. The good thing about it is that while you're Reef Sliding, you're invulnerable and you can go through enemies. You can use the Reef Slider under UFOs to trigger them into crushing boss 7 is under them. Take a look at how sick this clip looks. However, you also need to pay attention to where you're using it, especially when you're cornered, otherwise stuff like this happens. I would say, depending on how you use it, the Triple Ink Strike is almost as good as Booyah Bomb. Unfortunately, it does not have the initial armor upon use, but it's a very strong nuke that's also good at reviving teammates. In this clip, my Triple Ink Strike revives all of my teammates and also kills the flyfish in my way. Along with Booyah Bomb, Triple Ink Strike can expose grillers so that they are vulnerable to attacks, so those come in handy too. It can completely destroy all the flying enemies on top of fish sticks too. Triple Ink Strike can give you the needed break during a glowfly session to both replenish your ink and revive your teammates. Just remember to actually aim your ink strikes, as throwing them into the water will make it a complete waste of a really good special. Also, please keep in mind that you cannot enter swim form after activating Triple Ink Strike, so be careful. The Wavebreaker does not do much damage to enemies, so it's not as helpful as an offensive weapon. However, it is an amazing special when it comes to reviving teammates in a pinch. In this clip, the only survivor used Wavebreaker to revive both myself and my other teammate, and the radius of the Wavebreaker is quite wide too. Because of that amazing clutch, we managed to survive the wave. Similarly, in this clip while I was in a pinch, I dropped the Wavebreaker before I died. That managed to revive my teammates. This special is pretty good at turning the tides, especially when combined with other teammates' specials too. If you're the last member standing, just remember to use it early if you anticipate that you will be splatted, as the game might end before you can revive your teammates with the waves. Finally, we have gotten to the part where most people are the most clueless about, the extra wave. Sometimes after clearing wave 3, you'll be greeted by the King Samurai itself, Kohozuna, in an extra wave. You can identify when extra waves happen by the distorted victory jungle that plays after wave 3. Here's a comparison, so listen carefully. Also, just a quick side note, You might have seen from other websites or other sources that there's a way for you to tell whether there's an extra wave coming or not by paying attention to whether the game introduces wave 3 as the final wave or wave 3. However, I just want to assure you that this has been patched and it always says final wave now, just so you know. There is a gauge in your Salmon Run lobby that tells you how likely Kohozuna will appear the next time you win a wave 3. However, keep in mind that this gauge is not a guarantee, it is only a chance and it might also depend on the gauges of your fellow teammates as well. In terms of strategy, I don't have anything much to be honest. I've beaten Kohozuna a few times, but not enough for me to write a full guide on it. However, I do believe I have something important to share that can help out everyone. During an extra wave, the extra wave cannons loaned to you are the best way of dealing damage to Kohozuna, but you should not underestimate using them against other bosses as well. Since you get 2 extra eggs for each kill, keep in mind that the extra wave cannons do not consume any ink. In dire situation, you can even use extra wave cannons to revive your teammates too. I will now go over each of the boss Salmonids and how the golden eggs can affect them during the extra wave. Steel Head, launching an egg at its exposed orb instantly one-shots it. Steel Eel, launching an egg at a tail one-shots it. Scrapper, launching an egg at it stuns it. If it is already stunned, launching an egg against its back with a direct hit one-shots it. Stingers, launching an egg at it does massive damage but not enough to one-shot. It may be useful if you have a low fire rate weapon such as a charger, but if you have a high fire rate weapon, it's honestly better to just kill them with your main weapon. Moss, launching an egg at a moss does massive damage but not enough to one-shot. It will put the moss so close to dying that you can finish it off with your main weapon. Depending on how much ink you have though, it might be worth it to just use a bomb. Drizzler, launching an egg when it's exposed does massive damage, not enough to one-shot it, but you can probably kill it if your main weapon is fast enough. Flyfish, launching an egg at its trash cans destroy them one at a time. There is a way you can destroy both of the trash cans if you aim at the correct angle in between the two trash cans, but so far I've only managed to do it once. I'm sorry for that, believe me when I said I tried multiple times. The angle is just very specific, and it's too hard for me to get used to. Fish Sticks, launching an egg at a fish stick only kills 3 or 4 of the small flying enemies, so it's not worth wasting an egg for them at all. Big Shot, launching an egg does massive damage. Not enough to kill, but it's probably worth it considering how bulky Big Shots can be. Slammin' Lid, targeting the pilot one-shots it. Flipper Floppers, now this is the one that confused the heck out of me. In this clip, I managed to one-shot it with the launch of an egg. In this clip, however, I did not even get close to one-shotting it. At first, I thought it might have something to do with how close I was before I launched the eggs, or that I had to break the armor at least once before I could one-shot it. After all, Flipper Floppers actually come with an armor that breaks the first time it tries to dive into your ink. You can visibly see the armor break in this clip right here. Can you guess what the difference between the two clips was? Well, the answer is less obvious. Turns out, if the armor is not broken, you have to aim at its belly, not its head. I believe shooting its tail should work too, but getting this footage alone already took me more hours than I cared to count, so I'll leave that to you guys to figure out. If the armor is broken, however, you can shoot its head without any problem. Now for the Kohozuna itself. The Crab Tang is a really good DPS against the Kohozuna during extra waves. If you have Crab Tang, feel free to unleash it entirely onto Kohozuna. Otherwise, it's best to have one person distract the Kohozuna, while the other three take care of the boss Salmonids to gather enough golden eggs to use as ammo. The person distracting the Kohozuna, who I'll refer to as the bait, should ideally be the one with the highest fire rate weapon. Kohozuna can only use two attacks. The first is that it lunges forward. It's very easy to anticipate and avoid if you have a shooter class weapon or a high fire rate weapon. The second is that it jumps up and uses a splashdown attack. This is probably the best time for the bait to refill their ink, as it's pointless to try to attack while it's in the air. While the other members defeat bosses and gather eggs, they can try to use this way to signal the bait to move towards where the golden eggs are, so that the rest of the team can lob the golden eggs at it. It's honestly mostly down to luck how well you do during the extra wave, as the type of boss Salmonids that appear, the specials, the weapons you get, can significantly affect your chances of success. Regardless of whether you win or lose the extra wave, you are still awarded 20 points for clearing wave 3. From what I've gathered, the number of skills you get and what type of skills you get depend on how much time is left when you beat the Kohozuna, or how much damage you've dealt to it, the hazard level, and so on. I leave a link in the description to a tweet that goes more into detail for this part. Thanks to @LeonYoshi on Twitter for this information. Whew, that was a lot, huh? Thank you all so much for watching this all the way to the end. It took me a long time to gather all the necessary footage for this video, especially the XTRAWAVE footages, and putting them all together. So if this video helped you out, please consider liking it and subscribing to my channel. This will really help me out. I also stream sometimes at twitch.tv/razorie_, or I might even stream on this channel sometimes. I'm also looking forward to big ones in the future too, so I might make a follow-up guide depending on how well this one does. Feel free to come say hi and join my Salmon Run games if you want to play with me. Until next time, take care, goodbye!